Glory in the highest heaven, to the Father and the Son and the Spirit.
Now, if you're at Matthew chapter 8, I'll invite you to rise for the reading of the Lord's Word. So we'll begin in verse 22, or sorry, that's wrong, verse 18. We'll read to verse 22. Now when Jesus saw a crowd around him, he gave orders to go over to the other side. And a scribe came up and said to him, "Teacher, I will follow you wherever you go." And Jesus said to him, "Foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head." Another of the disciples said to him, "Lord, let me first go and bury my father." And Jesus said to him, "Follow me and leave the dead to bury their own dead." This is the word of the Lord. And you can be seated. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, once again, we are confronted with your word, and we pray, Lord, that you would open our hearts, give us ears to hear. We know that your word is living and active, and so we know that as we gather around it this morning, that your spirit will teach us and will do his work, and we invite that and thank you for it. Amen. If you had a bulletin, if you have a bulletin with you, you'll notice that today's message has the title, "Will You Follow?" However, there was, and I can't remember the name, I was reading one commentator on this, and he had said that you could also label this passage, "Will Jesus Take You?" And that doesn't sound right to our ears, because we're often used to hearing things like, "Jesus accepts you just the way you are." This morning's passage challenges that a little bit. We see here in this morning's passage, Jesus trying people and testing them. Testing the ones who said they would follow him. You see, Jesus was doing, you know, moving on in the sermon, in the Gospel of Matthew, if you've been with us, you know Jesus has been doing wondrous things. And we've read that there are large crowds, great crowds gathering around him. Right after he's preached the Sermon on the Mount, we read that the people were amazed at his teaching, because he taught not like their scribes, but he taught as one having authority. And he was healing everyone. Last week, at the beginning of the first 18 verses of, or 17 verses of chapter 8, Jesus is healing everyone. Matthew says, everyone who was, he healed all who were brought to him. And Jesus was present. He's preaching the gospel of his kingdom, and he's giving glimpses of what that kingdom is going to be like when it comes in all of its fullness at the end of the age. He's giving these glimpses. And so all who are brought to him, all who are around him are healed. There's no disease, no sickness. And if you just look up from the verse that we read, that portion of Matthew chapter 8 ends with Matthew quoting from the prophet Isaiah. He says, "He took our illnesses and bore our diseases." And Matthew, and I just want to take, maybe we could just break here, just so we can understand that little portion of what Matthew has quoted from Isaiah, because I think it's important. So let's pause the sermon and just give me a brief moment. Matthew quotes Isaiah, "He took our illnesses and bore our diseases." So Matthew, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, is quoting from Isaiah chapter 53. Right? In Isaiah chapter 53, most of us will know it. It's very famous. It's a passage of the suffering servant. And in this prophetic vision, Isaiah is receiving a prophecy about the Messiah, that he would suffer for our sins, that he would make a substitutionary atonement for our sins. Matthew now takes Isaiah chapter 53 and verse 4, and he includes in it that he took our illnesses and diseases. He draws out of what Isaiah says, making plain that this atonement for sin, this healing from sin, includes physical healing. And why is that being done? Why should we get there from that? Well, because all sickness and disease that we experience in this life comes out, is present in this world because of the fall of humanity. Because our first parents sinned and plunged the world into darkness, thus disease and sickness now ravage humanity. Jesus died dealing with sin. And if he's dealt with sin, he's necessarily dealt with disease and illness. You get rid of sin, you get rid of those. Okay? So that's why Matthew is taking place. This is why we see Jesus healing everyone. It's a glimpse into what his kingdom is going to look like when it comes in all his fullness. So, now, unpause and let's come back into the sermon and just have that lingering in your mind. It'll become relevant as we go on here. So Jesus, like I said, he's healing everyone. He's giving us that glimpse of what his kingdom is going to look like. And of course, that's the reason all these large crowds are gathering around him. People are following him in a very broad and a general sense. There's a lot happening. Emotions are running high. There's understandably this excitement about it. And here Matthew records for us that Jesus, in our passage today, that Jesus was quick to address the issue of those who would just loosely follow him. He's making sure there's no misunderstanding. Right? That those who are just taken up in the emotion and the experience and the excitement of seeing all these happening, that he's correcting any idea that following Jesus is going to be all that, and reminding them that if you are going to follow me, it will be hard, right? It is that straight and that narrow path. And so we see him interact with this scribe and this disciple. And so I think it's really important as we begin to look at that to remind ourselves a few things just so that we can interpret what's happening here properly. So we have this interaction between Jesus and these two would-be disciples. And I want to remind us that Jesus is dealing with individuals here. His specific comments, you know, one's about how he addresses each one of these two people. These are specific comments made to these specific people. Jesus, being God, knows what is in the hearts of those who come to him. He can read the heart. Beyond what is said on the exterior, he knows what's going on in your mind, in your thoughts, and where your heart lies. In John chapter 2, we read this. Now when Jesus was in Jerusalem at the Passover feast, many believed in his name when they saw the signs that he was doing. Now listen to what it says. But Jesus, on his part, did not entrust himself to them, because he knew men. He knew all people. And he did no one to bear witness about man, for he himself knew what was in man. So Jesus knows what's in the heart of these people that are coming to him. He's talking to individuals. It would be a mistake to take what Jesus is saying here and just blanket it over, take it as instruction for all people. And some have done that and come up with some pretty bad application. There is a thought that arises out of this passage that Christians should not attend the funerals of non-Christians. Because what Jesus says here about let the dead bury their own dead, that's a bad interpretation. So we need to understand that this is being spoken directly to these people individually. Now, that's not to say there's not a broad application that there is in this text for us. And it's fairly easy to detect. The principle that comes out of this passage for us is that there is a cost to following Jesus. It's not all healings and miracles and emotional highs. The road of following Jesus is not one paved in glory and power. Again, it's a straight in that narrow path. So there's that. And then the other thing I want to remind us of is what Jesus said to his disciples after he washed their feet. He said to them, "Truly I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor a messenger greater than the one who sent him." Disciples are not greater than their master. And we as disciples should expect to endure what Jesus endured as we follow him. So those two things should be, we should have those things in our mind as we approach this, what he says here. So Jesus, it says, when he came down from the mountain, great crowds followed him. And Jesus has done, he's preached a sermon on the mount, he's been healing people, and he's tired. He needs time to rest. So he instructs his disciples, he says, you know, get the boat ready, whatever, let's go over across. I need some time alone, I need some time in prayer and meditation. And so people are aware, the crowds are aware that he's getting ready to leave. And so some of them who are coming up and expressing their desire to follow him across the river, to become maybe part of his inner circle, the close, wanting to follow him more intently. And so we have the scribe, right? The scribe comes up first. And that's a bit unusual because he belongs to that group who in general are at odds with Jesus' teaching. The scribes and the Pharisees are often described as trying to trap Jesus. And ultimately, it's them that play the key role in having Jesus crucified. So the group that this man is associated with are generally hostile to Christ, and yet here we see him. Right? A learned scribe, an expounder of the law, and he comes on his own accord. He's not pressured by anyone. He comes on his own accord to Christ. Right? He likes what he sees and what he hears. And he says to Jesus, "I will follow you wherever you go." Yeah, that looks good. You know, if someone would come into the church today, someone who's maybe of a little higher status, professional status, someone who's learned or whatever, and we see them make a confession and say, "I want to be a disciple of Christ, I want to follow Christ," our natural reaction would be, "That's great, let's get this person in the church." And yet, how does Jesus answer? "Foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head." Huh? I read that and thought, Jesus is talking like my wife. Often don't have any context. I don't understand where this is coming from, right? She's downstairs, so I can say that, and she'll get mad at me because she's probably watching the video. Hi, Claudia. But you see Jesus' response, and you're kind of like, he didn't really doesn't seem maybe to answer the question. It's a little, you know, what's he getting at? Yeah, his response is indicating that this scribe, this man who just approached him, that his intentions are not altogether praiseworthy. Jesus heard what this man said, that he would follow him wherever he goes, but Jesus responds to what he knew was in his heart. As excited as he was from what he saw and heard and wanted to be close to Jesus, right? He wanted to be where the action was, but he also was not prepared to leave what he had. the comforts of his life. Right? This, he was a scribe, one who was, so he belonged to a group of teachers that was kind of officially sanctioned by the Pharisees to teach the people. So he most likely had a pretty decent life, a home, perhaps a family. He's comfortable, and yet he's following Jesus. He sees what he sees, and he's excited, and he's wanting the thrills because everything is that's going on. And so he just wants to, the indication is that he wants to add Jesus to the mix of things he already has. Right, I'll go with you wherever you go. This ministry looks exciting. And Jesus says, the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. And when he says the Son of Man, he's talking about his humility. Jesus is called the Son of God when it's referencing his deity. When he's called the Son of Man, it's referencing his humility, that he was born a man, and he gave up his glory and came to the earth to serve us. He says, I have nowhere to lay my head. Even the animals have a home, but I have no permanent dwelling place. Jesus didn't own a house. He didn't own a bed to call his own. He's saying to the scribe, first sit down and count the cost. Count the cost of being a permanent disciple. A student is not greater than his teacher. In the Second World War, there were many young men and women who signed up and went off to war with a romanticized idea of what they were heading into. And all too quickly, the realities confronted them, right? This is bad. This is not all parades and medals and glory. There is a cost here. You may end up in a parade. You may end up with a medal, but there is a cost to that decision. And the cost is great. Jesus is speaking to this man's heart. He knew that he would be unwilling to give up what he has to follow Jesus. Beyond this, it's also thought that Jesus is probably addressing some covetousness in this man's heart too. Right? The scribe saw the great miracle and the healings and saw the opportunity perhaps to, this is going to be a powerful ministry. This is going to be one where there might be some financial gain here because look at all that is happening. So he's wanting to get involved here. Perhaps make a living at doing this. And Jesus corrects him, making clear that far from growing rich or gaining glory, Jesus lives in poverty. He's got no pillow to lay his head on. And if this scribe wanted to follow him, he wouldn't fare much better. Jesus is not inviting you into a ministry that is going to lead you to a comfortable and rich life. Now, there's no record of how this scribe responded, but I think the silence that nothing else is said means that he decided to walk away. And there can be no doubt for us that following the Lord is full of blessings and benefits that are glorious, and they're not to be forsaken. But we can't misunderstand. Following Jesus is the way of the cross. That has to be understood. It's not a path of glory, nor of power, nor of wealth, nor exaltation, but of the cross. It's a path of weakness, of self-sacrifice, of humiliation. Right? That's the narrow path we're called onto. That's the path that Jesus walked, and a student is not above his teacher. And that, I think that's quite important for us today to grasp that. There are this this covetousness, this carnal desire that this scribe who wanted to follow, we see this in the church today. We see this in the church today. The idea that that signs of miraculous signs and wonders that are taught in such a way that we gain power and glory for ourselves. It is a very real element to some churches or ministries, and it is off course. And the reason I brought out Isaiah for us to understand what Isaiah is saying about healing and diseases and illnesses, because sometimes there is this teaching, and it's a prominent teaching, and that's why I'm wanting to speak with you this morning about it. There are some who teach that out of passages like Mark 6, and we'll read it in John and in Matthew here, where Jesus tells his disciples to go out, and he says to heal the sick, to raise the dead, to cleanse lepers, and to cast out demons. And there are teachers who take that as a command for the church, that this is what all disciples of Christ are to be doing: raising the dead, cleansing lepers, casting out demons, healing the sick, that this should be normal in the church. And I want to caution you against that. When you read those passages in context, Jesus is giving instruction to 12 disciples who are about to lay the foundation for the entire church. To then take that out and say all Christians should be involved in powerful ministries like this, it's not a proper interpretation. But what happens is when you teach this, it stirs up great crowds. It draws people because there is this excitement, there's this emotionalism, there's this idea that, man, we should be walking in this kind of power and doing this and this, and it draws people. It gets them, gets them in. They come in like a powder keg. And I even know, I know personally people who think that we should raise the dead. That's foolish. That's foolishness. And it's destructive, and it hurts people. Jesus, healing, raising the dead, cleansing lepers, getting rid of all diseases, was giving us a glimpse of what the kingdom was going to be like. He was in no way saying that this was going to be normative for the church across the ages, that we would be doing this. If that's true, if healing in the atonement is that, if that's true and it's to take place right now, then we have to ask ourselves some serious questions, because Jesus on the cross got rid of sin. And let me ask you a question. Do you still struggle with sin? Yeah. So Jesus on the cross got rid of disease and illness, but we still struggle with disease and illness. Jesus on the cross conquered death. You're still going to die. But when he comes in all of his fullness, you will have no struggle with sin. You will have no illness or disease, and you will not die. But in this time, you will experience those things. So don't be taken up into some teaching that seems exciting and gets sucked in by the promise of all kinds of excitement and perhaps even wealth. Many of these ministers are extremely wealthy, but they're problematic. Sorry, I just wanted to do that and to touch on that. It draws a lot of people. And yet the gospel of Christ is never preached. They're never told of the road of discipleship. It's all signs and wonders and power. Jesus knew the heart of the scribe. He addressed the issue. And the world for Christians should never be a comfortable place for us. Should never be a comfortable place for us. We're sojourners here, just like our Lord, and we're on our way to a better city. And then you have the second one, the disciple comes to Jesus and he says, "Lord, let me first go and bury my father." And Jesus' response is harsh and cutting. "Follow me. Leave the dead to bury their own dead." That's not the Jesus quote you see on a mug, is it? When I was reading this, I thought someone should start a line of mugs. "Yes, Jesus actually said that," mugs. Right? It's like, maybe we need a mug to remind us. Let the dead bury their own dead. We might need to hear it more than we think. But again, Jesus here, he's addressing this man's heart. And when we read it, because of our culture, we assume automatically that the man's father has just died. And he's asking to go and bury him. But we shouldn't be so quick to come to that conclusion, because in this culture, that the "let me go" or "let me bury my father" is a phrase that is used to say, let me wait and collect my inheritance before I go and do so and so. So it's very probable that this man is saying, "I will follow you, Jesus, but I'm waiting until my father, who is in old age, dies. I'm gonna collect my inheritance, and then I'll come, and then I'll be all in. And you know what? I'll probably have a little more too, just to give towards the ministry." And Christ's answer, like we said, is harsh and it's cutting. He says, "No. Follow me. Your preference must be for me. Don't delay in following me. Let the dead bury their own dead." Right? Jesus says, let the spiritually dead bury their physically dead. Right? Let them take care of it. Luke, in the same thing, he gives a little more information here, and he adds on to what Jesus said. Jesus says, "Let the dead bury their own dead," and then says, "But as for you, go and proclaim the kingdom of God. Follow me and put your heart to the task of saving the spiritually dead, who are alive and yet are in danger of dying both spiritually and physically." Right? Christ knew the request by this disciple, although reasonable maybe on the surface, was not right. The man was making an excuse. He wouldn't return if he left. He didn't have the commitment to the work. And so when Jesus confronts him with this half-hearted follower, we're assuming leaves. There's nothing said of him. We don't hear about him again. But he had excuses in his heart. All of us, some of us more than others, have put off something, right? Procrastinated. Doing something we know should have been done, but we just kind of always push it to the side. I have a small chip in my windshield right now that I've had for about 3 months, and I know the cold weather is coming, and I know that small chip will probably spread. I should have had it filled already. My wife has told me I should have, and I've just put it off. But eventually, if I don't do something about it, it's going to spread. Much more serious than that, some of us sometimes have, you know, we have laid on our heart, you should contact that person. Or you need to pray for that person. You need to be doing, you know, you need to send a thank you card or get in contact. And we push it off and off and off. And then it's too late at some point. How much more important is it when Christ calls you to be his disciple that you respond immediately? Jesus knew if he went back to his family, he wouldn't return. The time is now, he says, follow me. This decision is more important than anything else in your life, even beyond your closest family relations. Jesus in chapter 10 of Matthew, this gospel will say, whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. It's another verse for that mug series, right? Matthew Henry commented on this, saying, many, many people are hindered from pursuing serious godliness because they are overly concerned with their families and the repercussions that will come from them. Christ is saying, I must come first. I must come first. You know, often people have heard the gospel. Maybe there's some here this morning and you come to church semi-regularly, you have things you want to get done. You have goals you have before you really start to follow Jesus closely. I just want to finish school, you know, and then I will. I just want to get my family established. I just want to put more effort into work at this point so later on I can kind of get to the religious thing. Right? I'll eventually get there, but not right now. And so there's excuse upon excuse. And your response to that constant testimony, the Holy Spirit on your heart, is just to push it aside. I'll do it later. And Jesus' words are rattling. The decision to follow him is the most important and the most urgent. Jesus knew of this man that his heart was not all in it. And Jesus is not going to compete with your love of family or money or any other worldly thing that you might put before him. In following him, you are to come and to follow him completely, to lose your life so that you may gain it. And don't delay, for we don't know. We don't know when death will come. Right? It's appointed for man to die once and then judgment. When Jesus says, follow me, that is the most important thing. Leave the spiritually dead to bury their dead. You follow me. Leave the world behind. You have a greater task to do. Follow me and engage in the work of bringing dead men to life by preaching the gospel. And so as we close here, we see that general enthusiasm stops short of a full discipleship. Jesus can see your heart. He sees the heart of all men, and he's not interested in half-hearted disciples. Those whose interest is ultimately somewhere else. Right? He's addressing those who want in on the action, the power, the fame, the glory, and yet are not willing to give up things. And just to be clear, it's not the giving up things that gets people saved. The problem is the things that they're not giving up are getting in the way. They're stealing their heart. They value them more than Jesus. They take us off course. They make us delay. But for those of us this morning that are disciples who follow Jesus, what does this passage have to say to us? Well, I think that we can see that discipleship, obviously, and the whole gospel of Matthew is about discipleship. But what we can learn from this is that it's obviously important, and we are not Jesus. When someone confesses Christ, comes into the church, we are not Jesus. We cannot look at their heart and get right to the issue. But we need to be aware that there are people who will come into the church, you know, who confess Christ, seem to grow, and yet ultimately they will walk away. That is something we are to expect. I mean, Jesus, in the parable of the sowers, he said, when you preach the gospel, some are going to receive it with joy. They're going to burst up, right, like a plant. They're just going to grow really fast, but ultimately they're going to die and wither because there's no root. So in our discipling of other people, we need to be aware that this can happen. But also, there are those of us, I mean, hopefully most of us here, we have made that decision to follow Christ. And to you, to us, to all here following Jesus, I just want to say, great. Great is your reward. And how blessed is the hope to which you have been called. It's so great is your reward that the Apostle Paul prays in Ephesians that you would be able to grasp the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints. He reminds us that we've been saved by grace, and although we were dead in our trespasses and sins, he made us alive together with Christ. And listen, God has raised us up with him and seated us with Christ in the heavenly places, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness towards us in Christ. For those of us who have given our lives to Christ, we are promised a very great reward in the life to come. Amen. And I'll call the worship team up now to lead us in a closing song.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow.